Good evening, family. This is our last study in a series we've entitled, I Will. You know, so far we've talked about how we should have this attitude within us, a commitment really within us that says, first, I will worship. We've talked about how I will serve. Last week we talked about our possessions, our stuff, and the gospel of Jesus Christ, and how we should affirm, I will give and I will go. Tonight, we're going to look at the last, which is simply this: I will make a positive difference. You know, in Rainer's book, I Will, he uses a word, churchianity. Churchianity is not a word. I really think it should be. Rainer defines it this way. He says, churchianity is practicing our church and religious beliefs according to human standards rather than biblical guidelines. You see, in far too many churches, we're redefining church membership to be something different than the sacrificial and functional teachings we find in 1 Corinthians 12, for example, which, by the way, you're really going to dive into heavy tonight. When we look at the implications of this chapter, specifically look at verse 27 and 28, where Paul tells us this: now you are the body of Christ and individual members of it, and God has placed these in the church. Do you see that? Do you see what biblical church membership is? Members of the church comprise the whole, and they're essential parts of it. The Apostle Paul uses this body metaphor to explain that church members are a part of a body. Some have ears, others are eyes, some are feet, still others are hands. That's why he concludes this in verse 12. He says, for as the body is one and has many parts, and all the parts of that body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. So as church members, we're to function. We have a function, each one of us. We're to sacrifice. We're to practice vibrant Christianity instead of churchianity. The former is biblical. It's self-giving. The latter, churchianity, is unbiblical. It's self-serving. So how do we get there? How did we get there? This attitude of churchianity, if you will. In his book, Rainer discusses five symptoms of churchianity, symptoms that as a church we have to avoid at all cost. And the first is simply this: it's church is a spectator sport. You know, our church here at Scenic Hills is just chock full of sports fans, football, baseball, basketball, golf, you name it. And we all, self-included, we sit, we watch our favorite teams perform, we cheer their successes, we cry at their losses, we scream at the TV, yelling at the coach what he should have done or what he should do, as if they can actually hear us through the TV, or even if they could hear us, they would listen to our opinion. We participate, but we participate as spectators. We don't go through the grueling practices. We don't have the knowledge and experience of the coaches. We don't feel the pressure of the fans or school administrators or owners. We don't go on recruiting trips. We don't know what it's like not to win. But we sit back and we watch and then offer our valuable input as to what we think they should have done. Unfortunately, church in too many places has become such a spectator sport. Members attend, but they don't participate in any other activities. They expect others to do ministry. They sit back and watch and then offer their valuable input as to how it should have been done. You know, I don't know if this is a real story or not, but it goes something like this. Preacher walked into an elders and deacons meeting, and he could already tell as he walked into the room, the attitudes there was tense. There was a tenseness about it. And so he quickly offered up a prayer, and he said, welcome, guys. Before we get into the business of the day, Let's have a little time of sharing. Let's just go around the room and each of you share with the group how you shared the gospel of Christ with someone last month. So go ahead. Let's just start right here. To which he was followed by silence. Not one person responded. You know, it's easy to treat our church like a spectator sport. I'll just sit back and watch. The second symptom he discusses is this idea that the church is about me. We've talked about this before. And when we have this country club mentality about the church, we do not serve. Instead, we seek to be served. You know, we've paid our dues, so we expect everyone else to carry the load. You know, far too often, church leaders literally have to beg to get people to serve, to get people to teach, to get people to lead small groups. People ask for volunteers, and again, they're met with silence. People are too busy. They're too committed in other areas of their life. They're unprepared. They're unmotivated simply because their attitude is that of, it's really all about me. Biblical church life is about serving. It's about sacrificing. It's about giving. It's about putting others before our own desires and needs. Churchianity is about being served. It's about receiving. It's about getting our way. It's about insisting on our needs and wants before others. The third symptom. A church is about dwelling on its flaws. You know, in the early days of marriage, okay, both husband and wife can really see no wrong in each other. But then after a while, reality of life sets in. And we see that, you know what, my spouse is really not perfect. And when we see that, we're left with two choices. One, we can try to see the best in our spouses and love them despite their imperfections. Thank you, Dana, by the way. Or we can complain and nag about the shortcomings, about the problems, about their imperfections. Often, sometimes to the point of separation and maybe even divorce. So what's the better choice? You know, we really shouldn't be surprised when we find and see imperfections within our church, because we are the members of it, right? You know, go back and look closely again at the church in Corinth. Here are just a few of the issues facing that church. They had church members that were in cliques and had formed these little personality cults. There was a significant amount of carnal behavior within the church. Church members and leaders did not deal with sexual immorality and sexual perversion that was within the church. There's a significant level of worldliness and materialism. Church members were taking one another to court. They're suing each other. There was a direct and outright rebellion against apostolic authority. The church didn't discipline members who'd fallen into sin. There was a misunderstanding completely about spiritual gifts. They were abusing the Lord's Supper. They were abusing issues of liberty. And the church was dealing with heresies concerning the resurrection. All this in one church. You thought our church had problems, right? You know, you can be assured. If you're visiting with us tonight for the first time, let me tell you something about Scenic Hills. Our church is not perfect. And you can be certain that your preacher and your church staff are not perfect. And there is no doubt that you will find a lot of messed up sinners in our church. And we're all among them. You know, we have a real choice. We can practice churchianity and dwell on the flaws and be critical. Or we can practice biblical church membership and extend grace towards each other. The fourth symptom, the church has low expectations. You know, far too many churches don't expect enough of their members. Too many see the church as an all-volunteer organization. You know, just commit when you can, when you have the time, when it doesn't conflict with anything else. But that's churchianity. That's not Christianity. Too many times, all that is expected Sunday morning attendance, maybe a few bucks in the plate, and you're a member in good standing, and the church will pretty much leave you alone. I got to tell you, that's disastrous for any church, because the old adage is true. You get what you expect. And sadly, in too many churches, we don't expect too much. We expect way too little. The last symptom is simply this. Church has a cliquish membership. Kind of similar to number four, where churches have little involvement because of low expectations. Other churches have little involvement because most members aren't connected with key cliques or groups in the church. You know, you may not be invited to be a part of a group that gets together for this or for that, or it may be a family within the church that's been around for the since the church became the church, and they've got, you know, several family members with their families, and or it may just simply be groups who have socially associated themselves together for various reasons. And don't get me wrong, okay? In and of themselves, there's absolutely nothing wrong with any of these, unless those within those groups give off an attitude of superiority or control within the body. And they become closed off towards others joining or becoming meaningfully involved in the church. You know, a church whose members practice churchianity, typically there's two main causative factors, okay? Church members are first kept from functioning as biblical church members. The barriers can either be institutional, they're ingrained in the way the church is organized, or it may be attitudinal. There could be formal structures in place that just simply keep people from being involved, or there could simply be that traditional response of, well, we've never done it that way before. Secondly, some church members make a choice not to function as biblical church members, and they are at least tacitly allowed to pursue that path. No one keeps from doing it. And understand, both are wrong. Both are unbiblical expressions of churchianity. So what do we do to avoid those symptoms? What do we do to avoid being a church that simply practices churchianity? The answer is strikingly simple, and it's simply obedience. It's time to become those types of members in our congregations who are obedient. It's time to take 1 Corinthians 12 seriously and be a vital part of the body of Christ. It's time to say, I will. Okay? I will have the attitude of Christ and put other church members before my wants and desires. I will gladly participate in worship with my church fellow members as long as I'm physically able. I'll get involved in a group, in a class, in a ministry so that I can grow spiritually with others, and I will make myself accountable to them. I will go and I will share the gospel with others in words and in deeds, and I will not be ashamed of my Savior. I will give abundantly and joyfully, recognizing that God is the owner of all things I currently have and steward. I will participate in the life of my church because God leads me to do so, not because I feel compelled to, in order to please people or to overcommit. It's what God wants me to do. I will focus on what Christ has done for me and not on the flaws of my church, its leaders, or its members. And I will pray that God will use me as an instrument to revive his body, his church, for his name, for his glory. You know, as we wrap this whole study up, it's never been about what you can do, but it's always been about what you will do. Can you commit and say, I will? God bless.